Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. So let's begin by dissecting the news. The confirmation was grim, but perhaps not unexpected. According to the World Health Organization, the Delta variant is now the most dominant strain here in the Philippines. But the important question is, what are we doing about it? Are we doing enough to contain it? Just days ago, the Philippines recorded its highest single-day tally of new COVID-19 cases, a total of 22,366 cases. Tonight, we'll break down the numbers with the members of the Okta Research Group, an independent group of scientists and data analysts monitoring the government's pandemic response. Joining us tonight is Father Nicanor Ostriaco. Later, we'll be joined by Professor Guido David. Good evening, Father, and thank you for joining us again on the program.
Good evening, Christian. Thank you for having me.
Okay, so it's confirmed that 69% of the cases included in the sequencing comprised or were triggered by the Delta variant. But how are the numbers looking these days? Just a few days ago, we saw the highest single day tally here in the Philippines. Have we seen the worst or not yet?
You know, it's misleading to look at the 22,000 as one pandemic, because in many ways, the Philippine pandemic is really several local pandemics. And so we have to separate it into the different regions. What you're seeing in the last few days is that there is a surge in the numbers in the NCR and in Region 4A, with Region 3 following closely after that. And the other parts of the Philippines, including, for example, the Cebu pandemic, appears to be subsiding, but the epidemic, the pandemic that is occurring right now in the NCR and the surrounding regions seems to be increasing. And as my colleague and my friend, Professor Guido David, will confirm, what we're seeing here is that the reproduction number in the capital, which was slowing down, which suggested that the ECQ had worked, has actually, its slowing down has slowed. And we are waiting this week to see if there's a reversal, if the reproduction number begins to increase again. And that would be a sign that the pandemic is accelerating rather than decelerating, which is what we wanted to be doing this coming week.
Okay, just for context, the last time we spoke also on this program, you said that the surge was slowing down, but of course the numbers were still increasing. So what is the current reproduction number now in the National Capital Region?
It's about 1.5. It peaked at about 1.8, 1.9. And so we are waiting this week to see if that reproduction number continues to go down, which would indicate a deceleration, or whether or not that reproduction number will reverse itself and begin to increase. And only in the next few days will we be able to see that. We have to wait until Thursday, because the Tuesday and Wednesday numbers historically are significantly lower than the past, because they reflect the weekend. And with Monday being a holiday, we would have to basically wait a few more days to see, in a sense, what the true numbers are.
So in short, we should not be deceived by the numbers today. The number of new COVID-19 cases, 13,827. It's very, yeah, so, it's not so good to describe that as only, right? Because
Number. Those are quite high numbers, number one, number two. But they're artificially deflated because it's the Tuesday, Wednesday, and maybe this week, Thursday numbers. They are, you know, and when I woke up here in the United States, I look at our group chat and they are not as high as we expected for a Tuesday, but given yesterday's numbers, but they still remain higher than all of the other Tuesdays we've seen so far. So okay, it gives you a certain perspective.
When you say the R or the reproduction numbers somewhere between 1.5 and 1.8, again, for the benefit of our viewers, how many can be potentially be infected by someone who is positive for COVID-19?
So the reproduction number indicates exactly that. So when the reproduction number is one, it means that one COVID positive patient on average will infect one other person. If it's higher than one, which is what the current state of affairs is, then what you will see is that the pandemic is spreading, because in case with a 1.5, that means one person on average is infecting one and a half. So two will infect three. So the pandemic is slowly growing. So the larger the reproduction number, the effective reproduction number, the faster the spread of the pandemic.
Okay, what should be the reproduction number to be able to contain this virus?
So we want it as low as possible, of course, but it has to drop below one in order for the numbers to reverse, so that you will see that the increases will now become decreases, and then over time that the actual case numbers will drop. We were hoping to see that in this week or next, but again, we're still waiting over the next few days.
Okay, let's put that further in context. If the reproduction number is below one, so if someone is infected, he or she would not be able to infect another person.
That's correct.
And that person can be... Okay.
So over the course of a period of time, there will be a shrinking of the pandemic in the population.
Mm-hmm. And usually, by your projections, if the reproduction number goes below one, how long would it take before you see deceleration?
Well, once the reproduction number goes below one, then what you're going to see is you're going to see that the case numbers every day will begin to decrease. Mm-hmm. And the lower the reproduction number, the faster the deceleration, the faster the decrease. So, you know, we've gone down to 0.6 right after the April surge. And those are really good numbers. You know, that we can only pray for that at this time.
Okay, and of course, there has to be massive vaccination in the meantime to be able to support that, right?
So what vaccination does is vaccination will actually decrease the effective reproduction number, because now a person who is going to try to infect two, if one of them is vaccinated, then you can see that it will be harder for that person to infect others. And so the reproduction number will slow, and the transmission will slow, and the reproduction number will decrease. And so what we're seeing now is actually a race between the variants and the vaccines. That's what we're seeing in the NCR. The challenge, of course, is that vaccines have a lag time, because they take several weeks to boost your immune system. So this month of September, upcoming month of September is going to be a race, and we are going to have to pray that the vaccines win this race rather than the variants.
Now, speaking of this race, do you see the Delta variant, which is more transmissible, somehow, based on the figures that we're seeing now, outpacing the vaccination that we're doing?
Well, I mean, it's a close race at the moment. So based on the numbers I saw recently, you know, we're dealing with, in terms of the NCR, 80% of the adult population has been vaccinated with at least one dose. That translates to about 55% of the total population. These numbers will translate into fully vaccinated Filipinos in about 2 weeks, because the dosing interval is about 3 weeks for most of the vaccines. So over the course of September, the hope is that more than half of the Filipinos in the NCR will be fully vaccinated. We know here in the United States that once you pass that critical 50%, it begins to push back against the Delta. So again, it's going to be a really close race to see which one is going to win out. But my concern is that, you know, this is a race between the variants and the vaccines, but our healthcare workers have to bear the brunt of that entire race over the course of the month, because we're going to be at near critical levels pretty much all through that period.
How long is that period that you're talking about again? Just for people to get a better sense of this problem.
So the DOH, in its modeling, has imagined that we will be in an MECQ for the entire month of September. And, you know, we're looking at numbers now of the ICU, about 1,000 1,000 individuals in the NCR, in the ICU. Just to give you some relative, to give you a perspective, during the April surge, we maxed out around 800 Filipinos in the ICUs of the NCR. We're now at 1,000. And thank God the rate of expansion, the rate of ICU occupation is slower than what you would have seen in April, probably because of the ECQ and the vaccinations, but it's still 1,000. And so that's a lot of care that our healthcare workers have to provide over many, many weeks.
Okay. Now, of course, is it still too early to say whether we've seen the worst of this Delta-driven surge, right?
But it's still too early. That's correct.
But what are your projections in the coming weeks or even days?
So again, we're going to have to talk about the different pandemics. So in Cebu, the R is dropping nicely. It will probably hit around 1 in the next few days. So their surge has been mitigated. In the NCR, the surge continues to increase with an R of 1.5. We're hoping that this R will continue to drop. The worst case scenario is that the R will reverse itself in the next week. And if this is the case, we will start to accelerate again.
And how many new cases are you projecting?
You can ask Professor Guido that. He does all the projections. But I know in our discussions, again, with an R of 1.5, we were expecting it to peak next week and begin to drop towards the end of the month. Okay. I know that in our conversations, he has told me that, you know, we can't promise a drop now. I think is how our projections last week or 2 weeks ago had suggested the peak would happen this week or next. We can't promise that at this time.
Because what changed?
Well, because what's happened is that the pandemic is, like I said, the R has stalled. The decrease of the R has stalled, and so at the moment the pandemic is unstable in the NCR. It could accelerate. It could continue to break. We won't really know. The mobility, of course, has continued to creep up since we went into MECQ, and I know talking to some mayors of the NCR is there's a concern that. You know, the surrounding areas of the NCR are particularly hot, Region 4A in particular. And so once you allow them to return to the NCR, once you open up that bubble, then they could seed new surges in Manila.
Okay. Now, the two-week ECQ that was implemented in Metro Manila, for the record, that had a positive effect terms of containing the spread.
It did. It slowed down the R. In fact, it reversed the R. The R was rapidly increasing to, like I said, nearly 1.9 to 2.0. And what you're seeing is that since then, the R has reversed in terms of its increase. It had been dropping for the last week and a half. But now, as I pointed out, the drop in the R has stalled. And that, of course, is a concern.
What would be the logical thing to do from a purely health perspective, public health perspective? Do we need to go back to that kind of strict lockdown? Because
the government has said, you know, the NCR is not going to be subject to ECQ at this time. They have pointed to the previous ECQ and they said, well, we have not been able to restrict mobility to the levels that we could. They're hoping that the vaccinations. My concern, of course, is the healthcare workers are going to be so exhausted, they will ask for a lockdown. They will ask for a return. They will ask for a time out.
Yeah,
It's only a matter of time.
Just like what happened in August last year when they called for a time out.
Yeah. Because they'll just be wiped out. They're so exhausted. You know, they've been doing this for a month already. And then for another month, we're predicting high levels of ICU care for a month. Now, the hopeful sign, of course, is that we have significantly more isolation and quarantine facilities in our LGUs. And I can speak, you know, Quezon City, for example, has dramatically expanded its isolation and quarantine facilities from the previous surge. So we can protect our hospitals by expanding those facilities even further. And I hope that the MMDA, which I know has initiated those efforts, will continue to be successful at doing that.
Okay. Father Ostriaco, if I return to an enhanced community quarantine is out of the question, how then do you contain a Delta-driven surge in Metro Manila?
So what is happening now is the government is attempting to use granular lockdowns. And again, in Quezon City, they have been very good at this. They currently have 62 specific granular lockdowns. However, again, you know, there's only a limited number of lockdowns that you can implement in an LGU before you run out of personnel who have to monitor those lockdowns. So, and I know that in Quezon City, that's 75. So what, you know, so the concern, of course, is that these lockdowns will continue. But if the reproduction number reverses itself and we have an accelerating pandemic in the NCR, those granular lockdowns will also be overwhelmed.
Okay, Father Ostriaco, Professor Guido David is now online to join us. Thank you, Professor David, for joining us this evening. Good to have you here.
Hi, good evening, Christian, and of course, Father Nicanor.
Okay, we were talking about this this latest confirmation coming from the World Health Organization earlier that the Delta variant is now the most dominant strain or variant here in the Philippines, although not surprising, right? Father Ostriaco told me to ask you this question regarding your projections. I mean, we saw the grim numbers a few days ago, more than 22,000. My question is, have we seen the worst of this particular surge, especially in Metro Manila, or not yet?
The fact that the reproduction number is still greater than one means that cases will still rise. It's about 1.37 in the Philippines, and I think in Metro Manila it's about 1.45. It means that cases are still rising, though the growth rate will be decreasing now. So we probably have not seen the worst of it yet, but we hope that because the reproduction number is decreasing, especially in the NCR, and we're anticipating that in about 2 weeks, the reproduction number may be close to one already. So that means the downward trend may hopefully come. That means that the peak may come soon, maybe in 1 to 2 weeks. The peak will be there. We hope that it will peak below 25,000, but we cannot promise that. But hopefully it won't get close to 30,000 cases per day.
So the next 2 weeks will be crucial in terms of seeing the peak in these cases, the next 2 weeks.
Absolutely. The next 2 weeks will be crucial. So if we don't see a decrease in the reproduction number, then that means the reproduction number, it's probably not going to be stalling or leveling at a certain value. So it's most likely going to be either increasing or decreasing. And if it's not decreasing, then it will most likely mean that the reproduction number is increasing. And that means the trend has reversed, and you know it will be it will not be good for us if the reproduction number is increasing, because we will see it will lead to very high case numbers.
Okay, I don't want to be the bearer of bad news here, pero let's talk about the projections. The worst case scenario coming from your group, if the reproduction number does not decrease, let's say in the next 2 weeks. How big a number are we talking about, or are you projecting?
Well, it's too early to say, but if the reproduction number does not decrease, technically the sky's the limit until we introduce interventions that will reverse the reproduction number again. So it means that cases may likely just start to increase again and may even start to accelerate. Okay. But again, so even 30,000 would be possible, or even more than that. But again, you know, we don't want to get ahead of ourselves. These are just scenarios. Right now, based on what we're seeing, we may still be on track for a decreasing reproduction number. We're just being cautious in saying that.
You know,
hopefully it will decrease. We don't see a reversal, but it will depend. It will depend on the cooperation of the people. If we follow health protocols, because if we don't start, or if we stop following the protocols and we start having more social gatherings or something like that, more super spreader events, the reproduction may start to increase again, and it will be difficult to control at this level when we have so many cases.
Okay. Of course, I asked this to Father Nicanor earlier, but can you elaborate on how the two-week easy queue in Metro Manila actually helps slow down the surge or the acceleration of the virus?
Right.
And can the current MACQ actually achieve a similar effect?
Right. With the ECQ, we looked at the mobility, and the mobility decreased during the two weeks of MECQ. And this caused the reproduction number to decrease. So it went as high as 1.9 in Metro Manila. And it currently has a value of around 1.45. So that decrease in reproduction number is what we need before we start seeing a decrease in the number of cases. So basically what's happening is, or what we expect to happen is that we saw the reproduction number hit 1.9, and then it should slowly or rapidly start to decrease down to all the way to 1. And once we get to 1, that is the point when cases will start decreasing. So it has to come in two stages. First, the reproduction number will decrease from 1.9 to 1, and then from 1, it will cause the cases to start decreasing. Now, if we compare to last March to April, when we had the ECQ, the reproduction number then was 1.7, and somehow the reproduction number decreased to 1 very quickly. I think in about 3 weeks, it was down to 1. And so we saw the downward trend after 3 weeks, even though the cases were higher. And what could be the factors? One factor could be that mobility is a little higher now compared to last March to April. I mean, both ECQ and MECQ showed higher mobility levels compared to last March and April. And the second is, of course, the Delta variant, which is 50% more transmissible. So because of the Delta variant, it's fighting against it. So if we imagine we're using strategies to try to push the reproduction number down, but the Delta variant is fighting back and it's pushing it upward. So it's slow. It's taking us a longer time to push it down, but we're managing it. So we believe that the 2 weeks of ECQ was actually effective, even though the effect was not as great as what we saw last year. April. Yes. Okay. But so far we're still seeing a decrease in the reproduction number under the MECQ. It has been decreasing. It may have slowed down, you know, in terms of the rate of decrease, but it is still decreasing.
Okay. We know that the national government is not inclined to put Metro Manila, for instance, under ECQ again because of the economic costs, understandably.
Right.
But given the surge that you're seeing now in Metro Manila in particular, is your group looking toward that direction in terms of recommending a return to ECQ, at least for 2 weeks again?
Well, I mean, that's an option for the national government if things get out of hand. But right now, what we're seeing so far is that the MECQ is still working, at least for now. So what we hope is that we can continue the trend. If we follow the current projections, it may cause the reproduction number to decrease to below 1 by second or maybe even third week of September. So maybe we still have to give it a chance. We have to be patient. But in the meantime, we have to work together and make sure that, you know, we make the most out of this MECQ, you know, to make it work, to make the reproduction number decrease to below 1.
Okay. I'd like to ask both of you this question, which is often asked, especially in social media, especially when they saw the new cases of more than 22,000. The other day, a common question, I think you also saw this on social media, are things getting out of control now? What's your response to that? Father first, Father Ostriaco.
So unlike the March and April situation, the hospital occupancy is actually lower than it was in March and April. So we still have control of our health occupancy. Our health infrastructure is not as stressed as it was in March and April. However, the sheer numbers, right? So there are just so many and going through our isolation and quarantine facilities in our LGUs and our hospitals. So as Professor Guido points out, if this starts to accelerate, it will get out of hand. But right now we are actually, despite what people feel, because there are so many sick, it's actually in a better situation than we were in March and April at the apparently worse with fewer numbers, only because we have higher numbers of beds. Though of course our concern is always our Kababayans who are working in those hospitals.
Okay, we're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back. Welcome back to After the Fact. We're still joined by Father Nicanor Estrellaco and Professor Guido David. Both of them are from the OFTA Research Group. Okay, at this point, I'd like to talk about the recent survey conducted by the OFTA Research Group. I'd like to ask Father Estrellaco. Basically, I'm also seeing this kind of question. How do you reconcile such overwhelming support, if I may use that term, of the government's, of the national government's pandemic response, yet we're seeing numbers like 22,366 new cases in a single day? I mean, how do you reconcile that?
So I think it's important to put those results into context.
Okay.
The survey arm of OCTA Research, so there's another arm of our group that does public sentiment analysis, undertook this survey in the middle of July, prior to the Delta surge. So I think it's really important to emphasize that we cannot conflate the two. We cannot ask whether or not those numbers reflect current sentiments in the middle of the Delta surge. In fact, our research team, again, the survey side, is going to initiate a follow-up survey in September in order to compare the sentiments of our Kababayans before and during the Delta surge. So it's really important to separate the two, that this was, you know, these are sentiments of our Kababayans in early July, and the surge really begins pretty much a month ago. So we cannot conflate those two. And we will have to see what the next round of surveys reveals in light of the Delta surge and how the government has manage this current surge that we are in.
Okay, of course, surveys are just a snapshot of a particular point in time of public sentiment. But in this case, I think when the survey was conducted in July 12 to 18, the numbers were not exactly good as far as the pandemic response was concerned. Any insight on that? I don't want to put you on the spot because you were not the one who conducted that survey.
Well, I mean, if you look at those pandemic numbers, they were high, but they were stable. And I think one of the things that you're going to see is that people don't really think about absolute numbers. What they're thinking about is the change. I know that my mother, when she looks at the daily news, she is seeing the change from day to day. So if you've got numbers that are high, but they are stable, the perception, of course, is that everything is under control. When the numbers are rapidly increasing, especially they are tagged as record numbers, then the perceptions will be different. So I think what you were seeing there is that it's a reflection of the perception that things were stable. Yes, they were high compared to, for example, earlier points in the pandemic, but things appeared to be stable. The vaccine rollout, if you remember, was accelerating at that point to peak around the end of July, the beginning of August, or middle of August. So I think the perception, since we're dealing with perception, one could say that things were looking up. The Delta, however, had just arrived on the horizon. I mean, people knew it was there. People had heard about Delta everywhere else. But if you remember, it was only towards the end of July that we had our first official sighting of Delta. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's the game changer.
Okay. Professor David, of course, your group has been closely monitoring the numbers since last year. But now that we're dealing with an entirely different animal here, not entirely different, by the way, but a more serious, more virulent, perhaps more transmissible variant in Delta, what is your group's recommendation in terms of the government's response? Because they've been doing the same thing over and over again, promising to do this and that during a two-week lockdown, for instance. But what needs to change to be able to come up with different results?
Well, of course, you know, that's a loaded question. And in fact, I was in another program yesterday, and at that time we were, you know, discussing, you know, I mean, it was a friendly discussion. And at that time, I think I was misquoted as saying that I was actually recommending a three-week lockdown. It was not a recommendation. It was more like, you know, we were, at least in my mind, at that time, I was thinking of what the response could be if the numbers begin to get out of control. I mean, in terms of, you know, if we start seeing numbers like 30,000 cases, and we presented it as like options that the government could take, like, you know, maybe they could think of a lockdown if it's possible, or, you know, or just, you know, let it pass, let it run its course. But as for your question, definitely a lot of people have already mentioned about the testing, in that the high positivity rate indicates that there should be more testing done. And one of the possible strategies is, of course, conducting more testing, not just, you know, testing people with symptoms, but, I mean, doing some sort of surveillance testing, meaning, you know, doing more of randomized mass testing. And we do know that some local governments, for example, we heard in that other show that Quezon City has been doing some of this mass randomized testing. And what it does, it allows the local government to test people who are highly mobile. And in the process, they are able to determine if some of them are, you know, if some of them test positive for the virus. And even though they're not showing any symptoms, it would be good if we can test them and get them, you know, quarantined immediately before they spread the virus further to other people. And I know that there's another mayor I talked to. I haven't talked to all the mayors, but at least the ones I talked to, Mayor Toby, he said that they actually conduct this random testing to people who are violating health protocols, like people who are not wearing face masks or face shields. And they found a rather high positivity rate for them, like about 15%, which is very significant. So these are some of the things we can do. And also, you know, perhaps scale up contact tracing, although we don't have a lot of information on the level of contact tracing that's currently, you know, operational right now. Yeah. But as far as the pandemic, right now, I would say that we're not yet, it's not yet out of control. I know that we saw a very high number 2 days ago, or yesterday, in 22,000 cases. And it may seem like it's getting out of control, but when we looked at the average, it's still about, you know, I mean, it's not decreasing for sure, but it's not yet out of control. And the numbers in the NCR is fairly, I would say it's fairly in control if we can show that the cases will start decreasing in 2 weeks. Right now, the concern is that the cases in Calabarzon and, you know, parts of Central Luzon, not the entire Calabarzon, but parts of it, that's where the, you know, the concern is, because the situation is, I wouldn't say it's becoming unmanageable in some of these areas, but they would really need more vaccines there, and they would really need, you know, to be able to control the number of cases in those regions. Because even if we're able to heal Metro Manila, even if we start to see a downward trend, if these surrounding regions are not yet, you know, controlled completely, then it may pose problems, because as Father and I talked about, there could be leaks in cases from Calabarzon going back to Metro Manila.
Professor David, I'm going to allow you to expand on that, because people might misconstrue what you said. We're talking here of 22,366 cases. That's basically shocking, no? Because that's the highest single day tally. But you're saying that's still under control? It doesn't indicate that things are getting out of control?
No. Well, the 22,000 is a lot, but when we average it out over the week, The weekly average is about 17,000 cases. Yes, that's also a lot. Those are high numbers. Those are higher numbers that we have seen last March and April. When we say that the pandemic is going out of control, we're usually referring to the reproduction number increasing, and we don't know when the end would be in sight. If the reproduction number is decreasing, even though the cases are high, we have a sense of, okay, this might peak at this time, and we'll start to see a decrease in cases. I'll give you an example. For example, Cebu City, a while ago, a few weeks ago, people were saying that, you know, cases were not being controlled in Cebu City, and some people felt like the pandemic was getting out of control in Cebu City. Whereas when we looked at the reproduction number, it was actually decreasing. And we projected that Cebu City would have a downward trend by first week of September. And true enough, true to our projections, Cebu City had a downward trend right now. So the reproduction number decreased to less than one. So again, we're not saying that these are numbers that we should not be concerned with. Yes, we should be concerned with them. But in terms of the, you know, pandemic going out of control, it's that, I mean, there are a lot of factors that will come into play when we're talking about pandemic going out of control.
Oh, Father, same question. Para lang ano, kasi it's very hard to reconcile for a lot of us na we're dealing with such big a number and then things are not yet out of control. Okay, we don't want to panic here, but of course, that big a number is a cause for concern. For instance, if you're talking about 22,366 cases, even if a very small percentage, only a small percentage pertaining to the serious or severe cases, you're still looking at bigger actual numbers that could congest hospital facilities, right?
Yes. So it's I will build on what Professor Guido points out. First of all, the 22,000, if the 22,000 were an NCR alone, we would be overwhelmed. So we have to imagine that these numbers are independent pandemics, and we have to look at each of these pandemics. And as he pointed out, the NCR pandemic is actually not worse than what we were in March and April, number one. Number two, it's not the absolute numbers, but the rate of change that is so important. If the numbers were large and we were exploding out of control, which is what we saw towards the end of March, if you remember at the end of March, we went into ECQ pretty much overnight. Yeah. And the reason for that is that the perception, not only by our national government leaders, but also the numbers, suggested that we were in an explosive surge where the reproduction number was increasing out of control. And so we had to enact some severe restrictions of mobility in order to reverse that trend. That trend has been reversed. So even though the numbers are so large overall in the entire country, and we have not yet talked about the greater impact of those numbers outside the NCR, because the healthcare infrastructure is actually poorer outside. Yeah. So if you're asking, you know, what do those numbers mean? It means that there are other regions of the Philippines that are under enormous stress compared to the March and April numbers. But in the NCR itself, given our size, given the number of beds and the increased number of beds, it's actually still tolerable. But I have to say this in light of the fact that I know so many people who have lost their loved ones. And, you know, losing your loved one, it's whether or not the reproduction number is going up or down, a loss is a loss. Yeah. And with those large numbers, many of our kababayans are losing loved ones. And so that is the concern. And of course, I point out once again, our healthcare workers have been doing this for a month, and the projections are this will continue at these critical levels for another month. They're going to be wiped out. So you know, it's not about whether or not it's out of control or inner control. It's about the immediate day-to-day impact of our people, and that's going to wear them down.
Hello, Father.
Yep.
Okay. As a final point, I'd like to shift to an equally, not equally, but also an important issue. Face shields, especially with the ongoing investigation in the Senate now regarding the overpriced face shields and face masks. We know that face masks have a certain or specific function in terms of preventing the spread of a virus. But how about face shields? Is there any science behind that for us to use face shields on top of face masks for the general public, not just for healthcare workers tending closely to COVID-19 patients? Father.
So, you know, this debate has been ongoing. And I think the scientific rationale is that there is some benefit. The question really is when you how much benefit and whether or not the benefit is worth the burden, right? And so this is the concern. Now, the last time we had this conversation, it was out, the Delta surge had not yet appeared. And so people were wondering whether or not that additional 10%, and it, again, 10% is a number that's being thrown around. They were asking whether or not an additional 10% is worthy of the face shield. We are in the middle of a Delta surge. And, you know, every little bit counts. Now, I'm not talking about the cost. I'm not talking about potential corruption. I'm just saying that in the middle of a Delta surge, every bit of protection counts. And if it's an extra 10% in the middle of a Delta surge, I'm willing to say, look, let's just wear it for another month and get outside this Delta surge. And then we can go back and start talking about getting rid of them forever. But this is not the time to lessen protection when our reproduction number is still high and is, though dropping, has slowed down, potentially stalled.
Okay. Finally, Professor David, how are the numbers looking? Do you have any projections when it comes to how the numbers would look like, let's say by October 1 to 8, that is the time when our candidates will be filing their certificates of candidacy?
And I guess campaigning during that time or starting to campaign.
Technically, hindi pa dapat magkampanya, pero we know that here in the Philippines, they've been campaigning now. Okay.
Yeah, I've been hearing jingle ads. Well, what we're seeing is if the numbers pan out according to our projections, for example, in the NCR, and the current projection is that we will see a peak sometime second or maybe even to the third week of September. After we peak, the numbers will start decreasing. But because of the high base numbers, we will still be seeing high numbers in the NCR for some time. That means it may be until October, we'll still be seeing, you know, 2,000 or maybe even 2,500 cases per day in the NCR, maybe until, you know, let's say the middle of October. But after that, most likely the numbers will settle at some baseline values. It usually settles at some what we call a steady state value or a baseline value, wherein the pandemic is essentially under control, but it's just there. There will be some infections, there will be some cases, but it will be something that will be manageable. So just as an example, last year, after we had the surge in August, it settled down to a number of around 400 cases per day in Metro Manila. And that was very manageable that time. And then after the beta surge in March and April, it settled down to around 600 until July, the middle of July. Okay. And right now we're expecting it to settle at, you know, maybe a higher number. But of course, as we vaccinate more people, we expect that the numbers will continue to decline, especially once the base number becomes smaller. So what we're sensing is, unless there's a, you know, new player in terms of a new variant, well, we've heard about this new South African variant, but we don't know much about that yet. But as for me, I mean, this is my personal perspective that by October, the cases will start to become manageable, and yes, well into election period, well until Christmas at least. I strongly believe that we'll have a Merry Christmas, and I think Father shares my sentiment on that.
Let's hope so. Professor Guido David and Father Nicanor Ostriaco, thank you, gentlemen, for joining us this evening.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Good evening, Christian. God bless you.
God bless you, Father. And before we go, social media is flooded with messages or memes of Philippine Christmas icon Jose Mari Chan. That's as Filipinos start counting down to the start of the Burr months. Some netizens even dub September 1st as the start of the Jose Mari Chan season in the Philippines. Others are also making mock posters and preparing hashtags for the singer-songwriter's supposed comeback. But some are dismayed that the country is set to enter the Burr months while stringent curbs remain. Chan has become associated with the Filipino celebration of the Christmas season as his holiday tunes dominate the radio waves as early as September. So that's it for this episode. This has been your host, Christian Esguera. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.